Good morning, everybody. It's nice to see so many people in the hall after a lovely banquet and wonderful music yesterday night till 1 a.m. So I really thank you, all of you, for coming to this hall. We'll be starting our session. The instruction course is on strabismus simplified for a general ophthalmologist. The strabismus is often like perceived as a very difficult topic because probably most of the medical colleges are teaching may not be very good with the strabismus specialty. So that's why we find it very difficult. But it's very simple mathematics and physics. If you apply a very logical thinking, it's most logical subspecialty in ophthalmology. And if you just apply simple logics, common sense, you can actually manage any patient with strabismus. So we'll start with the first talk, Dr. Soumya. She'll be talking about equipments necessary for evaluation of a strabismus. In fact, I would like to say here that strabismus is one of the simplest branches in ophthalmology where you just need very, very minimal investment to start a practice in your clinic. Over to Dr. Soumya. I request my co-instructors, Dr. Kavita, to come out to the dais. Dr. Santan Gopal, sir. Yes.
Very good morning to all of you. I first of all thank Dr. Arun for giving me this opportunity to be a part of the IC. The talk is on simplifying the strabismus. So the first talk would be on simple equipments for strabismus practice. When we talk of practice, we usually think of two things. One, the evaluation. Two, the management. So we would be dividing this talk in this way. Equipments would include those required for motor evaluation, which would be the fixation targets, the occluders, the prisms, the red and green glasses. For the sensory evaluation, bar investigations, which would include Wirth 4 dots test, Bagolini striated lenses, the stereopsis charts, the Hess charts, the goniometers, etc., and those required for surgery. We would cover each of it in detail. Let's look at the first thing, that the fixation targets. For any squint evaluation, the first and foremost thing that we would need is a fixation target. The target should be recognizable, it should be resolvable. Two, it should hold the object or the patient's interest depending on the age of the patient. It should be larger than the threshold visual acuity. If the visual acuity is 6/6, we use a fixation target of 6/12 on a Snellen chart, and it should stimulate the accommodation. Essentially meaning, torch would not be a sufficient fixation target and should not be used. So the fixation target, so do we actually need, it's not moving, can I have the next slide? So when we talk of the fixation targets, do we need anything extra or do we have something in our ophthalmic OPD already? All of us have, can you play the video please? All of us have Snellen visual acuity charts which are a part of every ophthalmic OPD. So these fixation targets, either Snellen letter charts, Snellen number charts, or other parts of the E charts can be used as a fixation. In a younger child, we have these cartoon pictures which are a part of Snellen charts again, which could be used as a fixation targets. In a very younger child, we could, or in a verbal child, we could use a Allen picture charts or Lee symbols, which are again a part of Snellen chart. So we don't need any extra equipment, which is already there in our OPD, can be used as a fixation target. Coming to the next thing, apart from the fixation targets for the distance, we would also need fixation targets for the near. So the fixation targets for the near could be, the near vision charts, which are normally available. Then we have the Lang's fixation. sorry about this. So the near vision charts could be a... So the near fixation targets could be the near vision charts and the Lang fixation stick, which is specially designed for this purposes. In children or in infants, we could use the toys as well. These Lang's fixation charts are two things. One, it has pictures on one end, and the other end, it has all the number charts also, which could be used. In very young children, we could use the squeaky toys, which come very handy, and they not only make noise, but also can be stopped to make noise to use as a fixation targets. Apart from this, do we have anything else which could be used as a fixation target? All of us have smartphones in our pocket. So can we use the smartphones for squint evaluation? Yes. We have a lot of smartphone videos and apps which are available, which have nursery rhymes, which come very handy in every infant when we have to examine the squint, which could act as a fixation target because they hold the child's attention very well. So this come very handy. Apart from the fixation targets, the next thing we would need would be the occluders. The occluders could be the standard occluders, which are solid occluders, or it could be the translucent occluders like the Spielmann's occluder. So these occluders help us evaluate the squint. And these, apart from the solid occluders, the translucent occluders are specifically used in evaluation of both latent nystagmus or in the presence of a DVD, like we see in this video, when a DVD of the right eye is being shown, apart from the latent nystagmus. Do we need these occluders all the time? Not really. We could get away without using the occluders also. So what we need is basically our hands to be used as an occluder. So what we, in very young infants, they usually get offended with the occluders because we are introducing another thing in front of the child's eye. So we could use our thumb in infants to use as occluder and thus get the measurements done. In a very little older children, what we could use is our palms to record the, to measure the squint. Once we know the presence of squint is there by our fixation targets and occluder, what we would need next is to measure the prism, measure the squint. How do we measure the prism, squint? With the help of prisms, either a loose prism or a prism bars could be used to measure the squint. Once we measure the squint, what we would need is to do the sensory evaluation as well. The Wirth 4-dot test is the most commonly done sensory evaluation test in the squint clinic. Do we need an extra equipment again for the Wirth 4-dot test? No, this is already impregnated in the Snellen visual acuity chart, which would be used for Wirth 4-dot test. We would need just a pair of red and green glasses to be worn by the child or the patient in question to measure the sensory evaluation. And we would use a Wirth 4-dot torch basically to test it for near. So red and green glasses, again, is it a compulsion? Not really, because the retinoscopic trial set itself has red and green lenses which are there as a part of trial set. If we don't have a pair of red and green glasses, we could use these trial lenses in the trial frame and get away doing a Wirth 4-dot evaluation. The red and green glasses is an important thing to have because it could help us not just in Wirth 4-dot tests, but also in stereopsis acuity measurements, in diplopia charting, and the Hess charting. The Wirth 4-dot torch, again, can be made with the help of a normal torch. Just stick on the color papers along with it with an occluder, and that becomes a Wirth 4-dot torch. Then the next important sensory evaluation, which we would need, are Bagolini striated lenses. These lenses are basically have striations. So how does the light look through when the patient actually sees it, as seen with this in this figure? It sees as a line across the point fixation of light. So that is how you can differentiate between an NRC and an ARC as well. The next important thing would be the stereopsis chart, which could be TNO test or a tetmus fly test. I would not be going to assessment of stereopsis, which would be dealt by Dr. Kavita later. So the stereopsis charts, apart from stereopsis charts, we would require a red and green glasses or polarized glasses. There are some stereopsis charts where we would not need these polarized lenses or red and green glasses. These are basically Lang fixation charts or the Frisbee test. This is a near stereopsis being done. What is important to note is the child is wearing the glasses. On the top of it, the polarized lenses are on, and the stereopsis is being checked. The younger the child or the age of the child is not a deterrent to do the stereopsis acuity measurement. In fact, the infants or the children respond very well to the stereopsis acuity measurements. It's just the mind block that the children may not be able to respond to it, but they respond beautifully well with respect to the stereopsis charts as well. The next important thing is to measure the abnormal head posture. What we could use is basically a goniometer. This is what we have made in our own clinic. Use two scales and mount it on a 360 degree protractor and use that to measure the abnormal head posture, both the turns, tilts, or the chin up or chin down posture. The next important thing what we would need apart from the goniometers and the thing would be the red and green glasses to measure the Hess charting. The Hess charting again helps us to differentiate between two things, the incompetent squint to make it a paralytic or a restrictive squint, and also to note the amount of movement or the extraocular motility which is there in the patient. So you have the, I'm sorry about the contrast, the patient wears the red and green glasses. And then the assistant points out the green light and that we are able to mark it in both the eye, either with right eye fixing and left eye fixing separately. Then the red and green glasses again are useful to do the diplopia charting. The diplopia charting again doesn't need any specific or special equipment. You have the red and green glasses already. What you need is just a retinoscope. Use the streak retinoscope light, mount, show it on a wall. The patient is seated 1 meter away and ask the patient as to how the patient is seeing it. And thus, the diplopia charting can be done without any need for the extra equipments in the clinic. Then the not so commonly used are the synoptophore for the torsional measurements or the Lee screen and Lancaster red-green test, which are optional to have. The other things which would be needed, just before we think of managing any squint, what we would need is to do a force duction test, not only to differentiate between the two tests, but paralytic or a restrictive strabismus, but also to plan out which muscle to be done. What we need again is the routine tooth forceps, which are in the cataract surgery equipment set, or a Hoskins forceps, and perform a force duction test, which comes very handy. Apart from the routine conjunctival scissors and the tooth forceps which are required, the squint set would have a series of muscle hooks, so Von Graffis, the Jemisins, and the teasers hook, apart from the retractors and the calipers. What we need is a special sutures, or they commonly use the ones which are used in oculoplasty surgery, 60 or 80 Vicryl. Sometimes we also use a 50 Ethicon. These are the various instruments which are being used. Also important is to have a pair of Moody's fixation forceps when we would avoid the use of an assistant and you could get away doing the surgery yourself. So evaluation of squint is akin to mathematics, where 2 plus 2 is always 4 and it can never be 5. This is a picture of one of my patients who's got used to me examining her every time. She knows that a fixation target is to be used and a prism for evaluation. As soon as I finish her check, she wanted to check her dad, playing my role in it. Beyond all this, it's not the equipments which make a difference, but how we interpret it. As the saying goes, the eyes cannot see what the mind does not know. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Soumya, for that excellent presentation. Dr. Soumya is a consultant pediatric ophthalmologist at Shankara Eye Hospital in Bangalore. So she has highlighted how simple the evaluation is, the equipment necessary for managing strabismus. So all of you can definitely start doing strabismus practice in your own clinic with whatever the equipment you already have. There's a slight change in the order. Dr. Santan Gopal, our president of the All India Ophthalmic Society, has to go for another lecture. So he'll be talking to us about a simplified approach to vertical strabismus.
Today all my sessions are overlapping. That's why I had to disturb you people. I'm very sorry, Kalpana, Arun.
No problem, sir. It's your pleasure to have you here, sir.
Before he connects, I'll talk anyway. I'll go on talking. I don't know when he will connect. I'm supposed to talk about vertical strabismus. Now, when the question of vertical strabismus comes, what is vertical strabismus? Is problem with the vertical muscles a vertical strabismus, or problems due to oblique muscles is a vertical strabismus? There are a lot of confusion in the minds of the people. DVD, they say, is a vertical strabismus. DVD is not a strabismus. Vertical strabismus karke PowerPoint hai. Wo dekhna. He couldn't connect the, there was a video and photograph in my phone. He couldn't connect it. So I was sitting there instead of sitting that side. You managed very well, Arun.
Thank you, sir.
Now the question arises, a problem with the superior rectus can lead to a vertical strabismus. Yes, a problem with inferior rectus can lead to a vertical asymmetry. But what about a problem with an oblique muscle? Also can, in smaller amounts, give rise to vertical strabismus. When the oblique muscles have larger problem, they give rise to torsional strabismus. So therefore, when you say management of vertical strabismus, it's important to recognize which muscle is involved. Is it superior rectus or inferior oblique? When the eye is hypertrophic, whether it is inferior rectus or superior oblique in the opposite eye. Where the eye is hyper, it could be a problem due to inferior oblique and superior rectus in the ipsilateral eye, or it could be due to a problem of superior oblique and inferior rectus in the opposite eye. So you have to decide which is the problem. What helps you decide clinically is the cover test. Okay? Hypertrophic eye, if it is due to superior rectus overaction, okay, all the superior muscles are intortus. All the inferior muscles are extortus. If you remember this, it's very easy to distinguish. If it is due to a superior rectus paresis, the eye will be extorted. If it is due to superior rectus overaction, which can happen in some cases, the eye will be intorted. Okay? If it is due to inferior oblique overaction, the eye can be up, but eye will be extorted. Now, how do you differentiate inferior oblique overaction from superior rectus? Very simple. Look at the disc and fovea. If the fovea and disc are not in the same line, that means there is a torsional element. If the fovea is below, okay, if there is extortion like this, supposing this is the fovea, there is extortion, fovea goes down. So if the fovea is below the line from the middle of the optic disc to the fovea, if it is below the line, that means there is extortion of that eye. You get it? It's very simple. Take the ophthalmoscope or take a streak retinoscope, and through the streak retinoscope, look at the disc. You can look at the disc through the streak retinoscope. Has anybody tried that? No? Okay, try next time. Now, when you look at the disc, keep the streak horizontal. If the disc and fovea are not on the same line, that means there is extortion. If the middle of the disc and fovea is not in the same line of the streak, that means there is torsional problem. If it is above, it is in torsion. If it is below, extension. Very simple technique. You don't need a lot of equipment. But, however, when you want to deal as he hasn't started the time. Doesn't matter. Leave it. I'll talk just like that. I'll make them understand. Don't worry. Start the time. I have only 4 more minutes to go. Now, what is important is there are many conditions affecting inferior oblique, superior oblique, inferior rectus, superior rectus. So how does a general ophthalmologist go about dealing with this and decide which muscle to tackle, which muscle to not tackle? Because inferior oblique muscle, he's like mother, very forgiving. Superior oblique muscle is like your girlfriend, very troublesome. And you handle the superior oblique improperly, it will curse you for the lifetime. So be very careful. Inferior oblique muscle is very nice muscle, very gentle, soft, like mother. You can cut it, burn it, it doesn't trouble anybody. Okay? So as a general practitioner, general ophthalmic practitioner, you have every courage to touch inferior oblique. If you feel that it is inferior, I'll give you one small example. Some fellow, after my talk, went and said, you can cut the muscle and all. It was a vertical squint. He said, this must be due to problem with inferior oblique. possible his diagnosis is correct, but he cut off the inferior rectus. Then he sent the patient, sir, you said you can cut the muscle. I said, yes. But I cut the muscle and the eye is hypertrophic even more than what it was before. He had cut off the inferior rectus. So fortunately, there was no problem. He sent the patient. I found the inferior rectus, because if you don't tackle the other attachment of the inferior rectus to the oblique, it stays there. So I brought it forwards and resected. So when you listen to my talk, please listen a bit more carefully. If I say cut the muscle, nothing happens. Yes, inferior oblique you can cut it, nothing happens, but not inferior rectus. Okay. So don't remember parts of my talk and blame me. Santan Gopal said cut the inferior rectus. Was it rectus or oblique? He gets cut. No, no. Some muscle he said cut it off. I said, oh, I cut it off and I began. So therefore, while operating, you must be very careful in deciding which muscle to operate as far as vertical muscle is concerned. Second, since there are many causes for inferior obliques, inferior rectus, superior oblique muscle problems, then you cannot decide just clinically which muscle to operate. You may need force reduction test, you may need MRI also, you may need dynamic MRI in some cases. Okay, these are all the investigations which you have to complete, because your diagnosis, if it's superior oblique, if it's congenital or acquired, depends. If it is a, for example, the monocular elevation deficiency which is acquired, that's what I wanted to show, then you need to do MRI to see where is the problem. Here a patient came with monocular elevation deficiency, acquired monocular elevation deficiency, which probably just a superior rectus, but this is a hypertensive patient, so I had to do MRI to find out where is the problem. So like that, if any vertical squint, the things you have to keep in mind is you must decide which of the eight muscles, to confuse you even more, there are, God has given two inferior obliques, two superior obliques, then two inferior recti and two superior recti. He totally confuses you. But there is a reason why he has given eight muscles for vertical movements. So you have to decide which muscle to operate, which muscle to tackle, what to do, and when to do, and how to do. These five things. Now, when you tackle a vertical or an oblique muscle, you must be 100% sure which muscle you are tackling, except when you can't tackle inferior oblique. Even if you make mistake, nothing happens. Generally, please remember, don't tackle inferior oblique for some other muscle, but generally nothing happens. But all other muscles, as a general ophthalmologist, be careful. You must get MRI done. Depending on where is the cause, you must get a force reduction test. And remember, DVD is not a squint. Okay, I'll stop at that. Thank you very much. Sorry for all the confusion. It never worked.
Thank you very much, sir. Even without the slides, you made an excellent presentation. Next, we have Dr. Kavita, who is a consultant pediatric ophthalmologist at Shankara Eye Hospital in Shivamogga. So strabismus is not a thing where you can diagnose with investigations. You cannot send for an OCT or a FFA or some other investigation and get the diagnosis. So strabismus diagnosis is clinical. So your clinical examination has to be very, very accurate. And Dr. Kavita will tell us how to go through the steps of evaluating a child with strabismus. So if you have anybody has any doubts, you can just feel free to ask us immediately.
My sincere thanks to Dr. Arun for giving me an opportunity to talk here, and Kalpana Madam, it's always my pleasure to come back to Coimbatore and see all of them here. Most of the slides have been repeated by Dr. Soumya here. It will overlap. I'll try and make my effort to skip those. So basically, there are two parts. One is the sensory evaluation and the motor evaluation in a squint patient that needs to be examined. Sensory testing is ideally done before binocularity is disrupted by occlusion of either eye, because you tend to get false reading of the strabismus measurement, and done after correction of any refractive error if present in the child or patient. So these are the two things. You do the sensory test first and then correct the refractive error if present. And the third thing is assessing the binocular single vision, stereo acuity, and anomalous retinal correspondence. This, I think, Dr. Soumya has covered. Just a word on this. Worth 4-dot test you have to do for both distance and near after correcting the refractive error. One important thing that you can diagnose here is monofixation syndrome, which quite often we miss. There might be a slight disparity in vision in one eye, and there is something abnormal, but you can't find out. Then, if that is the case, then think of monofixation syndrome. A simple test, Worth 4-dot test, you can detect this, where fusion is there for near, but for distance, the patient will be suppressing one of the eyes. So in that case, you can think of monofixation syndrome. You have a very subtle squint, which you can miss on doing your alternate cover test, less than 3 degrees or 3 prisms. So in such situation, this Worth 4 test comes in handy. Although we have sensory testing, most of the tests in squint, we have to remember that it is done for distance and near with or after correction of the refractive error. Just remember this. And for distance sensory testing, we have the AO Vectograph and Mentor BVAT system. This is not available in our local use. That's what last time when we conducted a CME, Dr. Santhan Gopal was telling, use these principles, Kavita, and try to do one locally here for distance stereoacuity testing. It's not so easily available. We have one more, which is called the Frisbee-Davis system for measuring the distance stereoacuity. For near, all this was elaborated and by Dr. Soumya. But one thing, the Titmus fly test is quite convenient to do it, but it gives there's a disadvantage. One can guess in this test. So ideally would be the TNOA test. There is no monocular clues. Begolini striated glass lenses you can understand whether there is binocular single vision or not, or there is dominance in either eye. Suppression can be made it, or if there is any central scotoma as seen in this picture here. So in that one particular eye, you have a bare area. So there, they have a central scotoma. Yet another simple test, but useful test, is doing the Worth 4, 4-prism diopter test. So when in a normal fixator, in a normal person who has binocular single vision, when you keep a 4-prism diopter prism with base out in front of one eye, you can see the corrective movement. There's a refixation movement. But this does not occur in monofixation syndrome. So there is suppression scotoma at the center. What is important is to understand head posture. There are 3 components for it. One is chin position, face turn, and head tilt. Position of head it usually is seen in paralytic or in concomitant squint, in which the eyes are in a position of no deviation or very small deviation so that fusion is possible. Coming to motor testing, you have the light reflex test, which totally depends this test on the light reflex at the pupillary area. You can use direct ophthalmoscope, which detects a deviation but does not measure the angle of deviation. You can only say whether this patient or child has squint or no squint, as you can see in the picture. So there is the red reflex, which you see in the pupillary area. Here it is not there. Here there's an abnormality in the reflex. Roughly 1 millimeter of displacement of this reflex is equal to 7 degrees. But if you want to convert into prism diopters, then it becomes 15 degrees, that almost double. Now coming to Krimsky's test, it is a simple test where you keep the prism in front of the deviating eye. This also is based on the corneal reflex or light test. especially done in children with poor fixation. See, you, the criteria for doing any of these cover test or alternate cover test or prism test, there should be a prerequisite. That is, the child should have good visual acuity. Only then there is a refixation movement. If the vision is poor, then it cannot take up fixation. So in that case, you can do the Krimsky's test, which is an what we see the reflex. But Krimsky test underestimates the angle. So we have one more test, the modified Krimsky test, where the deviating eye, it's now reverse. You keep the prism in front of the normal eye. So especially in densely amblyopic or blind child, you can do this test. It gives a better estimate of the angle of deviation. As you see in this picture, the eyes are looking almost straight. So we think we might assume that there is no squint. So let's see this video when we start doing the cover, uncover test, and alternate cover test. You can see a subtle deviation. Many times you need to do this repeatedly alternate cover test to bring out the latent squint. You can see that the eye is moving out. So this is known as phoria. So there is no manifest deviation, but there is an underlying squint. Here in this case, you can obviously see that the right eye is deviating outwards. What do we do next? We cover the left eye and then see what happens in the deviating eye. It is taking up fixation, that means the vision is okay. Now after you do the alternate cover test, you can see what happens in the other eye. Similarly, you do for near but with a target. Cancel, no? We have to cancel that.
Selector.
So you're using a target. It could be anything, a toy with some fine features on the toy. So you do the alternate cover test and interpret whether the other eye is taking a fixation or not. Same thing you do using the prism bar or loose prisms. So you do that until you... until there is no... a point where there is no deviation or... refixation movement or a corrective movement. So there is no deviation after that. In case the angle is large, you can use two loose prisms. So for near, you can use this. The other one is the simultaneous prism cover test. It measures the, that means on one eye you have the prism, the other side you have the cover. It measures the angle under normal binocular conditions. The disadvantage is it is measures only tropia. It doesn't have given any estimate on the phoria, even if you do, you can't, because you can't do alternate cover test. When you do alternate cover test, the more squint which is present underlying or beneath, it gets manifested. So it's useful in accommodative esotropia and MFS. The other thing is doing extraocular movements. What I would like to show you here is the video here. This is a doll's head maneuver. In this child, you can see that left eye has ESO, but it is not abducting. Left eye is not abducting at all. So there is something to do with LR muscle, which is not working. So LR palsy can be understood. Now, what about vertical deviations? Just a video. See, after covering and underneath the cover, what you can see is that the right eye has gone up and then takes up fixation. The other thing which you have to understand is the patterns. You have basically A and the V patterns. In the A, the deviation is more in the up gaze, while in down gaze it is lesser. FTT has been shown. The saccades are fast eye movements, which is nothing but a refixation or sudden command movements. Patient is asked to see two different targets on either side, then you can record the velocity of the same. In palsies, it is usually reduced. Then you have the Maddox rod test. Synoptophore nowadays hardly we are using. The other important thing is the PARC3 step test. It is useful for vertical muscle palsy. First, you look at the in primary position the deviation. Then you see what happens to the eyes in the both the gazes, right gaze and the left gaze. And after that, you make the patient tilt his head to the right and the left. Very useful in vertical muscle palsies. To conclude, we need to evaluate the vision. A good cycloplegic refraction is required. Rule out media opacities, but last and most important is the fundus examination. You may have squint, but there's something in the macula which is dragging and then causing sensory deviation. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Kavita. One important thing I would like to highlight here is use of accommodative targets. So you can never do a cover test with a torchlight. You always need to have accommodative target. And nowadays, the simplest accommodative target what you can have is your mobile phone. You just switch on the camera, put it in the selfie mode, and show it to the child. So every child would love to see their own face on the mobile or on the screen. So the moment they start seeing at their own face, they are very cooperative, and you can easily do the cover test without any problem with the accommodative fatigue. So that's one thing I would like to highlight. Any questions for Dr. Kavita? So if there are no more questions, I would like to go to the next topic. That is the most important topic for a general ophthalmologist, because most often you'll be seeing the esotropias and exotropias. So you'll all be interested in knowing how to manage the simple esotropias and exotropias. And we have none other than my teacher, Dr. Kalpana Narendran, who is also responsible for this wonderful conference we are having here at Coimbatore. So she'll be telling us about management of horizontal strabismus.
Thank you, Arun. Thank you for the opportunity. Good morning, everybody. And I have to admit that Arun was my first fellow. And we learned together. That's the truth. And he was he's a very nice person. If you have a motivated fellow with you, you will make wonders. So coming to my topic, approach to horizontal strabismus. In general practice, the horizontal strabismus is the most common thing we would confront with. And horizontal strabismus, two types of deviation. One is a eso deviation where the eye is turned in. The other is exo deviation where the eye is turned out. So I'll be talking about eso deviations first and then move on to exo deviations. And if you look at the type of eso deviations, they are either concomitant or incomitant. The concomitant deviations, it could be accommodative, partially accommodative, or non-accommodative type, where you have the essential infantile esotropia or congenital esotropia, which is very common. Then you have late onset esotropia, acute concomitant, microtropias, cyclic ETs and sensory ETs and nystagmus blockage syndromes are all different forms of eso deviations. And incomitant, it could be paralytic. The sixth nerve palsy or the divergence palsy or even sometimes myasthenia gravis can present as an eso deviation. And under the restrictive category, you have the Duane's retraction syndrome and strabismus fixus and spastic. I'm not going to the details of the incomitant deviations. But when you see a patient presenting with eso deviation, it may not be a true strabismus. So one should keep in mind that it could be a pseudo-esotropia. See a child like this here. With a flat nasal bridge, with the broad epicanthal folds, with small interpupillar distance, always keep in mind. But then the take-home message of this patient would be that always ask them to come for review after 3 or 4 months, because you never know. It might turn out to be a strabismus. So be cautious when you see a child with esotropia. That might be an underlying pathology as well. So this child here is an infantile esotropia patient. You can see here a small child. You can see the alternate esotropia. Always, try to hold the head so that the child does not move the head. So this is a case of infantile esotropia. The features of an infantile esotropia, there are two types. One is a consistent feature, other is a variable feature. The consistent would be that usually it presents from birth to, 6 months of age. And usually they have large angles, more than 30 to 40 prism diopters. And the angle is usually stable. It will initially be alternating, and one nice thing about congenital esotropia, if they have a cross fixation, they do not develop amblyopia. And their central nervous system is normal, and they might have an asymmetric optokinetic nystagmus. The variable characteristics would be, they have might be an underlying amblyopia, abduction limitation, or sometimes excessive eduction. they can have dysfunction of the obliques. You can have either a superior oblique overaction, most commonly inferior oblique overaction. They might have a pattern associated and dissociate vertical deviation, and also have a latent nystagmus and smooth pursuit asymmetry in optokinetic drum. So the other clinical feature would be, because of this early onset and constant character, sometimes they tend to have a disruption of the binocular visual development and might be associated with amblyopia. This disruption of binocular visual development and stereopsis now has a role, because sometimes when you don't treat these children at a very younger age, the stereopsis is lost, and then you know they tend to sometimes sacrifice and take some profession. Sometimes some people come, I want to be a pilot, or I want to be in the security. But sometimes they do not have stereopsis, then they have to change their dreams. The differential diagnosis for esotropia would be congenital sixth nerve palsy, Mobi syndrome, which is not very common. This child here is advanced refractory syndrome. You can see the narrowing of fissure and the esotropia. And clinically, you have to carefully assess them. I'm not going to the details. Visual acuity assessment is very important. Always see the size of deviation. This child here, I just wanted to show you that there is a, you can see here, this is the inferior oblique overaction. So this is what I wanted to show you here. And it's mandatory to do a cycloplegic refraction and a detailed fundus evaluation. And the management would be, if there's an underlying amblyopia, please treat the amblyopia with the conventional occlusion therapy. And preferably the surgery should be done if you diagnose before the 1 year of age. And otherwise you try to improve the visual acuity, treat the amblyopia, and then go in for the surgical procedure. The surgical options would be bimedial recession, the associated inferior oblique overaction, go for inferior oblique recession or myectomy. And resect procedure in one eye, or sometimes you can even do a Farden in case of accommodated esotropia, which we'll be talking later. So always keep in mind neurological association, hydrocephalus. Be very careful, because children can present as esotropia, and I think practicing pediatric ophthalmologists would know at least one patient you would have like that. I mean, it happened to me. Shruti, I remember the patient. I don't know if Arun, you remember the patient. Presented with esotropia, everything was normal. 6 months later, the child had a VP shunt done and lost faith in me. That's the story, actually. So you should keep in mind that retinoblastomas present as esotropias. So it's very important to do a detailed fundus evaluation. The accommodative esotropia is the next thing which you would commonly see, that we always say that squint patients say, is it to be surgery to be done? No. Some of them can be treated with glasses as well if there's an underlying accommodative component. In the accommodative esotropia, the three types could be fully accommodative, partially accommodative, or high AC by A ratio. So this child here, the 7-year-old girl, is squinting for the past 4 years. This is a fully refractive accommodative esotropia. So this is just to show you. I think they have shown with the glasses on. Yeah, now you can see that. So it's very minimal. So this is a fully refractive accommodative esotropia. And then this is a partially accommodative esotropia, this child here. This boy here. So even after wearing the glasses, there is some amount of residual, 25 prism ET. So this, based on the amount of deviation, you can plan for surgery, either a bimedial or recess and resect. And this is my next patient. This is a refractive accommodative esotropia with the AC by A ratio. So these patients, you have to give them, you know, glasses with the near addition of 2.5. which will make them comfortable, see better. So this is a patient with high AC by A ratio. So one should remember that. I think Aliso will be done.
No, you can take your time, madam. Just take three, four minutes more.
So the treatment of accommodative esotropia would be, give the full correction of refractive error and always advise the patient to wear the glasses constantly, treat the underlying amblyopia, and always monitor for fixation vision. Especially younger children, it is very important, because children do not complain. So again, this is very important when you see the accommodative esotropia. You know, very specifically we say that executive bifocals, which would bisect the pupil. So when you give a prescription to the optician, it's very important to draw and show where it should, you know, where should, the line should bisect. And again, orthoptic treatment definitely has a role in strabismus. So depending upon the presentation, if not treat the non-accommodative component, if it is less than 15 diopters or more than 15 diopters. So you have a lot of options with fusion, without fusion. You can go and treat with prisms or orthoptic exercises. And the choice of surgery, I already mentioned about it. It's a MR recession, bilateral MR recession or recess-resect procedure. And then beware of missing a sixth nerve palsy. So very, very important, do a detailed fundus evaluation in suspected cases. Cyclic esotropia is a very rare entity, but then parents come with a typical history. This child is apparently normal here, but then the mother says that he presents with a squint on and off. Sometimes the cycle, it might last for 24 hours, then the next day he'll become completely normal. So you have to keep this in mind. And the incidence increases. So once you see the child, you can treat this child, and you can treat what angle of deviation is presenting, he can be operated, and the results are fairly good. So this is cyclic esotropia. Sensory esotropia, if a child has a vision, this is mostly because of stimulus deprivation. So you can see this little microphthalmas here with coloboma. You can see this child has got esotropia. So this is sensory esotropia. So coming to the exodeviations, again, exodeviation is the most common form of strabismus you would encounter. It could be a committent, incommittent. Primary, you have infantile exotropia or intermittent exotropia. Secondary exotropias could be because of stimulus deprivation. And then consecutive exotropias. Incommittent could be paralytic, restrictive, or like we already talked about, Duane's retraction syndrome, and then dissociative horizontal deviation. So this child here is a two-year-old child with constant squinting. You can see here. If there is a constant squinting, cross fixation is not there usually in exotropia, so you have to be cautious that if there's an underlying amblyopia, you have to treat this. This is a very young child presenting with a large exotropia, and then the deviation was constant by 6 months of age, and then amblyopia is associated in 25% of these cases. And these children also have an increased incidence of cerebral palsy and other neurological disorders, and sometimes ocular albinism patients can have this. So surgery should be done again at an earlier age. And if you operate at a very younger age, be careful that you don't bring a consecutive esodeviation. And again, pseudoexotropia, if you have a positive angle kappa with a wide interpupillary distance, there is a chance that it can be a pseudo-squint. Intermittent exotropia, it's mainly because of the, you can see here this patient. He looks normal, but when you break the fusion, you can see that eye takes an exoposition. So this is intermittent exotropia. So it's usually latent, but with a period of time, it becomes manifest. So this is the intermittent exotropia. So if in adults, if the patient has astenopic complaints, then you have to proceed for surgery. In children, you can wait and watch. If the stereopsis is maintained well, you can wait for surgery. Otherwise, you go ahead and plan for surgery. And the classification of exotropia, I'm not going to the details of this. Usually they're asymptomatic, then sometimes they have astenopic symptoms. That is what they complain, and horizontal diplopia. And very typically the history would be that when child is daydreaming or with fever or down after a tired day, they start manifesting. Then the associated features, you have to see small hypertropias, there'll be AV patterns, there'll be this child here, the inferior pubic overaction. So this is what you have to see. And XTs are usually progressive. I said it can be influenced by a lot of factors. There'll be decreased tonic convergence, increasing age. If there's any associated suppression, then it can progress. Loss of accommodative power. And then increasing age, again, divergence of orbits. That's what makes it more progressive. So I already mentioned about this. So surgical management, depending on the presentation, you would do a recess-resect or a bilateral dactyl recession. Then the non-surgical options would be that always correct the underlying refractive error. Overcorrecting minus therapy can be tried for exotropias. Part-time occlusion, if there's any amblyopia. Prisms and orthoptics do have a role. Botulinum toxin, normally we restrict only for paralytic squints. So measurement, I'm not going into the detail. Patch test definitely has a role in exotropias. Sometimes we're not very sure about the angle of deviation. You can do a patch test. And then, by breaking the fusion for some time, it will allow you to measure the true deviation. So that is what is patch test. So I've already gone through this. So word about consecutive exotropia. This boy, 4 years, presented esodeviation, operated, remained orthophoric. This is how we looked at 15 years, presented at 24 years with a deviation like this. So consecutive exotropia is also common. Here, this boy again is a consecutive exotropia. So we did a medial rectus advancement with lateral recession, preferably an adjustable, because it's not a virgin muscle. It's already operated muscle. Then the results are not, you know, like what you would expect. So always put them into adjustable if you're not comfortable. Again, a sensory exotropia. This boy had a scar in the eye. He was operated. So thank you for the opportunity. And I would like to conclude with our founders, my favorite quote from him: intelligence and capability are not enough. There must be a joy of doing something beautiful. And that is why this conference turned out to be like this. I hope you enjoy the rest of the stay here. Thank you.
Thank you, madam, for the excellent presentation. I request Dr. Rohit to load his presentation. In the meanwhile, two things here. One thing is, like as ma'am said, pseudoexotropia, many a times we just say pseudoexotropia and just leave it off. And many a times after 6 months or 1 year, you'll see that the child actually develops a true squint. And so important is to follow up. Even if it is pseudoexotropia, you call them back after 6 months for checkup. The other thing is, many a times you will see parents complaining of a squint. Parents will say, my child has a squint. But when you see in the clinic, there won't be any squint at all. So there are only two possibilities here. One is an accommodative esotropia or an intermittent exotropia. So you have to use an accommodative target to check for that accommodative esotropia. And you ask the patient to first a very distant object, probably if you have a window in your room, which is very rare nowadays. So you can just ask them to fix at a very distant object through the window, and then you will notice the exodeviation. The two things. Other thing is, like, to simplify whatever ma'am has said, the principle of managing a esotropia: if your child comes with esotropia, do a cycloplegic refraction. Cycloplegic refraction is very, very critical in managing any patient with strabismus. So do a thorough cycloplegic refraction. If the child has hypermetropia, give him glasses. If there is no hypermetropia, probably child may require surgery. So that is the principle of esotropia. Next, we have Professor Rohit Saxena, who is from AIMS RP Center. I think he doesn't need any introduction, but he's one of the authorities in nystagmus. So he will tell us how to manage a child with nystagmus.
Thank you very much, Dr. Arun, and thank you for making me a part of this course and this wonderful conference. And Dr. Kalpana, an outstanding one, truly, with of course, the temperature is also warm, but otherwise also exceedingly warm. Really, in nystagmus, these are, I would say, rather exciting times. It's exciting times for actually pediatric ophthalmology and strabismus. Everybody who's here, who's involved with this specialty, will tell you that the best about our field is there's so much yet to come. And that's the beauty. In other fields, maybe we've already advanced so much that incremental growth is slow. Here, on an everyday basis, we learn so much about new, about the same disease and about new diseases and how to manage. And the challenge itself is the most exciting thing that we have. So just a bit about nystagmus. We have various types of nystagmus. It's sometimes difficult when a child comes crying, not very comfortable with wriggly eyes. You just don't know what is happening and what you need to do. You need to be very comfortable and quiet and try and understand, get the parents and the children to be at ease, to explain to them that these are things that require a long-term association and are not things that get treated in magic. So a rhythmic, involuntary to and fro movement of the eye, every word in this is very essential when you're diagnosing nystagmus. They can be pendular or jerky. The direction is according to the fast phase. It may be horizontal, vertical, or rotatory, and all these have often very significant value when you are trying to look at acquired nystagmus. But here I'll be essentially talking about childhood nystagmus. The other thing is conjugacy. Conjugacy essentially means that both eyes have same or similar movement, but disconjugate, that there is different nystagmus in the two eyes. You need to know why that is there. It can be there because there is asymmetric vision, so the better eye vision is able to dampen the eye movement and therefore have better vision, or there may be other major problems like a spasmus nutans. So you have ocular oscillations. You need to know whether it's nystagmus. The nystagmus gets diagnosed if it's rhythmic, involuntary, and to and fro. Others may not be having these characteristics. Nystagmus, then you need to know whether it's physiological or not. So physiological has certain conditions. It's end gaze. It dampens in a bit. It only occurs momentarily. There is no visual defect with it. Pathological nystagmus would be congenital or acquired. Again, you need to identify acquired nystagmus. The person patient who comes in is usually very symptomatic, would have oscillopsia, would have some other neurological cause. Else, it is congenital. Of course, when in doubt, get an imaging done. And it could be sensory or motor, although it's not generally discussed as sensory motor by CMAS. The most common pathological nystagmus in infancy or early childhood is an infantile nystagmus syndrome, earlier called congenital nystagmus. Fusion maldevelopment, earlier called latent manifest, manifest latent or latent nystagmus as spasmus nutans. So INS is the most common what we see in an ophthalmology clinic. It's uniplanar, binocular, no oscillopsia really, although patient may sometimes tell you that he is occasionally aware of the images moving. It's abolished in sleep, it dampens on convergence, which is something that we use for our management, and there is a distinct ascending slow phase velocity. The latent manifest is again, conjugate, it's horizontal, it's jerk. The important thing is fast phase towards the fixing eye. So you alternate the fixing either eye and the fast phase or the beat moves towards that direction. That is characteristic, and another characteristic is decreasing velocity of the slow phase. And that helps us because latent manifest nystagmus is really never associated with any intracranial pathology. And spasmus nutans, you must know, because a small child coming with a head posture, head nodding, asymmetric nystagmus in the first 6 months, you are concerned because they are associated with chiasmal gliomas and you require neuroimaging. If it is not associated with a chiasmal glioma, you may just wait it out. It tends to get better. So imaging required in all cases of quiet nystagmus, periodic alternating nystagmus, seesaw nystagmus, spasmus nutans syndrome, and when you have poor vision and you're not sure why that's happening. We've talked about the head postures and measuring it. For nystagmus, it's important that a patient doesn't walk in with a head posture. You wait some time, let the patient read down the Snellen's chart. Only when there is a visually demanding task, as the patient is running down the Snellen's, you can see that the head posture is developing. Otherwise, at most times, the patient is straight. So this is the amount of head posture actually the patient has. And if you're planning to operate for it, that's what the level, that's the correction you require. You can do nystagmography, either electro or video nystagmography. And these are the kind of waveforms you get. All these squiggly lines, sometimes it's difficult to understand, but you can see wherever it's flattening out, it's a little better. So here you can see they're much better. Primary, as you can see, the lines are so close to each other that the patient has a face turn in left gaze. So what is our aim of our management? Stabilize the eye by improving visual acuity, decrease the eye movements if possible, shift the null to primary position if there is a null. And how do we actually achieve improvement of vision? So this is kind of a nystagmogram flattened out a little. The patient is able to see when the object of regard is within plus minus 5 degrees at a speed which is lower than 4 degrees per second. So only for a very short period of time, and that's marked by these red lines, is the patient able to see. All other times, any impulse coming from the retina is actually suppressed, like it is suppressed when we do a saccade. During our saccade, we don't see things moving. The image just remains on the brain for a bit, and then the new image comes on. That's what happens in nystagmus. So it's only in these periods that a patient can see. And how can we bring about a change when we flatten out these images? So this period above these lines is the time when the patient can see, and that's the time how you are helping the patient to improve. What all can you do? So you have a target, you have the retina, refractive correction, get good quality imaging. The nystagmus can dampen. As it moves higher and higher, you have on the motility, you have drugs and neurosurgery from higher centers to the ocular motility system. And from motility system to the extraocular muscle, there are biofeedback mechanisms, including acupuncture. And finally, from the extraocular muscles to the target, you can have surgery, botulinum toxin or prisms. A lot of options. Optical correction remains the single most important intervention you can do. So please, first step, do check best corrected visual acuity always. Retinoscopy in null position, you can think of over minus classes, particularly in INS, as accommodation does tend to dampen the intensity of nystagmus and therefore improve vision. But the patient has to be able to do that. It's not always an easy thing to do. Management of amblyopia, again, a single most important thing, you must manage it. Occlusion is actually not an absolute contraindication. You see an initial increase in the nystagmus, but as the vision improves, it profoundly influences it far greater. However, if there is an initial difficulty or resistance, you can do penalization or overplus glasses and then go on to occlusion as the visual acuity improves. Prisms can be used to stimulate convergence, which will dampen the nystagmus. You can use prisms to check the amount of head posture and measure the change in the head posture, and we prefer to use Fresnel prisms. Medical management, you have a lot of drugs. Most of them are useful for acquired nystagmus. For congenital, we did this study on brinzolamide eye drops, and we found it to be relatively effective in those patients who do not have a head posture. That, of course, is under print right now, and there is now a topical medical management that can be considered. Some of them do actually feel better. Botulinum toxin, however, it's a short-acting, so again, only for acquired. Alternative therapies, contact lenses help not only by contact tactile method, dampening the nystagmus, but also the eye moves with the refractive correction and therefore he sees better. Acupuncture is something we tried in our hospital. You can see before needle insertion and with time the flattening occurs, but the moment we remove it after 20-30 minutes of removal, it tends to go back. So during the period, the patients were extremely comfortable and happy with the acupuncture device. You can do surgically. The aim of surgery is either inducing convergence, shifting of the null position, or to reduce the amplitude of nystagmus. For shifting of the null, correction of face turn, you have numerous procedures. We use the augmented Andersons in our hospital, and we tend to find it very beneficial. You can dampen the nystagmus either by supramaximal recession of all four recti or the Hertel-Dulosso all four recti, horizontal recti tenotomy procedure. Face turn, like I said, we use an augmented Anderson's procedure. We do the recession of the yoke muscles, a very large recession. Again, it can be proportional or dependent upon the amount of head posture, up to 12 mm recession of the lateral recti and 9 mm of the medial rectus. The benefit is that just in case if you operate a pan or it shifts onto the other side, you can do the opposite yoke and get the correction. And the limitation or to eye movements is not too much. It is, of course, easily reversible. So these are some of the cases which we had done. This is again a picture to show you how on electronystagmography there is a change. This is the primary gaze. You can see after correction of head posture, this was on dextro and levo version, which remains. However, the null has been now shifted to primary position. It was here in the levo version. Again, you can correct for chin up and chin down positions, for head tilts where you can do oblique muscle surgeries. This child had a head tilt and we operated on bilateral superior and inferior obliques to correct for it. And to decrease the nystagmus amplitude in those who do not have head posture, you can either do all four horizontal recti recessions, supramaximal, doing again 12 millimeter lateral recti, 9 millimeter medial recti. The effects is not very long lasting, and therefore it's not something we routinely offer to our patients. The other option was the Hertel-Dulosso procedure, in which they just remove the horizontal recti, cauterize the stump and replace it there. They believe that it helps in managing the tactile sensory fibers that are there at the nerve endings. And well, we've tried it in our center, and we did find that it works equally well compared to all four recti recession, which is not saying much actually, because even that does not work so well. But an option can be given to either of the surgery in patients who have nystagmus without a head posture. Therefore, like I started off with, these are exciting times. There is a lot of things that are coming, and we hope that over time there'll be more opportunity to offer and manage our patients. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Rohit, for the excellent presentation. Do we have any questions for Dr. Rohit or any of the previous speakers?
I have a patient who has only head nodding. How to go about mm-hmm. it? I got a neurological...
The head nodding is not associated with nystagmus, or it's because of nystagmus?
No, nystagmus. I'm just asking out of the way, because this child was referred to me, but then the pediatric evaluation
everything
is
else
normal.
Is normal.
No refractive error, no squint.
If you hold and fix the head, then you examine the fundus, are there small nystagmus movements? That's the only thing we tend to miss. These are micro nystagmus that we miss. So either the head nodding is because of neurological cause, which may not actually be a serious neurological issue, or it may just be controlling. But the most common cause is a small nystagmus which the patient is actually, you know, compensating for. So actually it is good. There's, I would personally say that I would never, you know, worry about a head nodding, and I would always tell the patients that, parents, that if the child head nods, it's very good unless there is something I feel there is a problem. So the nystagmus is for, you know, if there is no nystagmus, then I would say that just follow up the patient.
Probably I have to examine the fundus then. The second part is the counseling part, because the head nodding is quite...
it's very severe. It's very severe. So maybe, like
because
I said...
It's intimidating.
And it may be retarding his functional activity. So like I said, just check for micronystagmus. That is one of the things we tend to miss in a gross ocular examination. You see, when you see the fundus, you'll see the fovea, you know, kind of, you know, moving very slightly, but very rapidly, so that it's difficult for us to pick up on the corneal reflex. But that's one of the things I can think of.
Okay, thank you.
That was a study we had done at our center, because there was so much literature on acupuncture and nystagmus. In fact, there's so much literature of acupuncture on retinitis pigmentosa and all, and well, we are looking at anything we can get. We are trying to get our hands on anything we can. We found it was effective. However, it was not long-lasting. So that is why it has not been able to be converted into actual therapeutic interventions. And unfortunately, we as, you know, allopathic medical professionals are a little resistant to, you know, ideas from other fields of medicine. But I would say that there is a lot of literature that has talked about it. But, well, we are hoping for a breakthrough sometime.
Thank you, sir.
It's not available, of course, commercially or otherwise. And we tried it out, and it was... working only till the time the acupuncture needles were there and the sternocleidomastoid.
Sir, I read an article that rotatory nystagmus synchronous with heartbeat is a treatable form of it. Is it possible?
No, I'm sorry. Rotatory nystagmus, which is synchronous with the heartbeat.
With heartbeat is a treatable form of nystagmus.
Is a treatable form of nystagmus. Rotatory nystagmus per se itself is very, very difficult to treat, I would say. If it's primarily rotatory only, we would, you know, be really at a wit's end to manage it. And synchronous with the heartbeat, I would probably say we need to see why he's having it, because there may be some some lesion that may be associated. So, I mean, we need to identify the cause, but often I would say I don't know. It's difficult to say. A rotatory nystagmus with a head posture, I'll treat the head posture. If it's just rotatory nystagmus, I don't think I would really go in for any form of intervention. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Rohit. Now we'll be moving to the last part of the
Can I give you an introduction, Arun? I just want to tell two lines. Dr. Arun has been consistently presenting, we are part of this instruction course for quite some time,
yes.
3 to 4 years at least.
Yes.
And I want to congratulate Arun for every time he puts forth, it's been selected. That is one point.
So I should thank the scientific committee chairperson, Dr. Lalit Vama, for that.
But it's been changing, you know, from 3 to 4 years we have been coming on this course. The other thing that I wanted to tell you are the first fellow and a student under Kalpana Madam, and you worked the similarity and difference I'm telling. Both of us from Bangalore, we came to Coimbatore, and you were a student here under Kalpana Madam. I went to Shankara. You are a direct student. I'm an indirect, distant. When ma'am was telling, I was feeling I want to tell, you know, like a child, I want to tell her even I'm a student, but distant course or distant learning. I was in Shankara, tele-learning.
Like Ekalavya.
Okay, I welcome Dr.
You.
Arun.
Thank you for the introduction, Dr. Kavita. So again, as I said in the evaluation and the management, like strabismus is a very simple form of managing this entity. If you are a good anterior segment surgeon, definitely you can do a strabismus surgery. In fact, in Western countries, the residents are first introduced into strabismus surgery, and only then they are allowed to operate cataracts. Whereas in India, it is opposite. You first master your cataract and then try to see the other things. So strabismus surgery is definitely technically not difficult, and all of you can do this procedures. provided you know when to do, what to do, and how much to do. So that is the only question you need to answer. So aim of any strabismus surgery is either to correct the misalignment or restore the binocular single vision. These are the two aims. And how do we achieve this is either by weakening the muscles, shortening the muscles, that strengthening this, or by modifying the plane of action, the transposition procedures. So most often the indications for strabismus surgery could be to improve the cosmetic appearance, or relieve the asthenopia, eliminate diplopia, or restore stereopsis, or correct an abnormal head posture. And the preparation for surgery is very, very important, because as I said, when to do, how much to do, what to do is the most important component of surgery. Doing surgery itself is quite simple, and I'm sure all of you can do a much better strabismus than what we are doing. So you need a complete knowledge of the anatomy, the ocular physiology, and the diagnostic techniques and whatever the surgical resources you have. I would like to emphasize this point, because whenever a patient comes with strabismus for the strabismus surgery, you have to satisfy not only the patient's parents, the friends, the envious neighbors, everybody will start commenting on the surgery. So you should be very, very clear as to what to expect from the surgery, and the patient should have realistic expectations. So never promise anybody that you'll correct the strabismus 100% and he'll look absolutely straight in all the directions of case, though you'd love to have such a result. So explain the possibilities of having undercorrections, overcorrections, recurrence of the strabismus, and possible necessity for a resurgery. And coming to the instrumentation, it's very, very simple. Anybody having an SICS set, definitely I think you will have muzzle hooks as well as calipers. So your SICS set is sufficient for you to a decent strabismus surgery. So you don't need to have any specific specialized equipments for a squint surgery. Anesthesia is most important. Though most of us are used to operating, I was surprised to see yesterday that most people do cataract surgery without the standby anesthetist, but strabismus surgery I would suggest not to do without a standby anesthetist. Anesthetist is very, very critical, otherwise your eye will always be on the pulse oximeter and you will not concentrate on the surgery. So anesthesia you can either do on a peribulbar anesthesia, which is the most often done anesthesia for adults, whereas in children you may require a general anesthesia. Some people, Dr. Santan Gopal, have been doing under topical also, but I personally have no experience with topical anesthesia. Other thing Dr. Professor Pradeep Sharma highlighted yesterday, it's very, very important to do with a magnification. At least for the beginner, you always prefer to do under a microscope, because that illumination and the magnification which the microscope gives, you will not get with any other loops or whatever other modalities you may try to do the strabismus surgery. So it is always safer to do it under a microscope. Anatomical considerations, it's very important not to operate more than three recti muscle because of the risk of anterior segment ischemia. And also there will be a lot of variations at the site where the muscle gets inserted. So it's always better to measure from the limbus than the site of insertion. And also you should remember that the sclera is thinnest at the insertion of the muscle. So where we are taking bites while they are doing a resection, you should be very careful not to perforate the sclera. The most commonly used is a 6-0 vicryl suture with a double arm spatulated needle. And in some instances, you may need to use a Dacron suture like a Fadden's. And I think it has been highlighted in the previous talks, the force duction test, very, very important. Even after you give the block, you just do a force duction test once again to confirm the motility of the eyeball. Here you can see there is a gross restriction. So this indicates there may be a muscle contracture. Coming to the conjunctival incision, for a beginner, I would always recommend that you go with a limbal incision, because a limbal incision gives a better exposure of the muscle and it's much easier to do the strabismus surgery. Once you are a little more comfortable with the incision, then you can go for a fornix incision surgery, which gives a better scar in the palpable aperture. And these are the features of an ideal conjunctival incision, which produces a minimal scar in the palpable apertures. That's the reason the fornix incision is a better incision compared to a limbal incision. Gives adequate exposure, ease of performance, and ease of reoperation, postoperative comfort for the patient. So these are the features of an ideal conjunctival incision. Coming to the choice of operations, we either can do a weakening of the muscle, strengthening of the muscle, or change the direction of action of the muscle. So these are the various weakening procedures. The recession, either can be a conventional recession or a hangback recession. You can do a marginal myotomy, a myectomy, or a posterior fixation suture of Fadden surgery. The strengthening procedures are the resections, the applications or tucking, and advancement. And these are the various transposition procedures which can be done on the muscles. So coming to the surgical dosage, if you have a child with esotropia, normally what we tend to do is a symmetrical surgery, a bimedial recession. This gives the best results in a child with esotropia. So it gives a predictable result and also technically less difficult. And these are the approximate results you get with a bimedial recession. Suppose if you do a 5 mm bimedial recession, you'll be correcting about 30 prism diopters of esotropia. Monocular surgery is usually done in amblyopic eyes, where the patient may have a poor vision in one eye. That's the reason usually you do a monocular surgery. Otherwise, symmetrical surgery is the preferred procedure. Coming to the exotropias, bilateral laterectus recessions is the most commonly performed procedure. And if there is a convergence weakness type of exotropia, which is more on near compared to distance, then probably you may consider doing a bimedial resection. And in a basic type of exotropia, it could probably do even a recess resect procedure. And those are the approximate results you get with a bilateral laterectus recessions. Coming to the surgical technique as such, the maximum advocated recession for a middle rectus is about 6.5 millimeters, and for a lateral rectus, it's 9 millimeters. Because if you do beyond that, it goes beyond the arc of contact of the muscle to the sclera, and it may produce a limitation of the movement. So hence, it's not advisable to do more than this. And at the same time, we have to remember the minimal amount of recession which has to be effective, because you're cutting the muscle, suturing the muscle. So the minimum amount of surgery which has to be done for it to be effective is about 2.5 millimeter for the middle rectus and about 4 millimeters for the lateral rectus. This is the technique of recession of a rectus muscle. You just do a limbal incision, as I said, hook the muscle, and I was trained with Dr. Kalpana, so we used to cut the suture into two and use two separate sutures. Some people are used to using a double arm suture for each muscle. So once you disinsert the muscle, you just measure the amount of recession you want. You can use a pen also to mark it, marker pen. It'll be useful for the beginners particularly. And then you suture. The scleral bite is the most important, and that's the reason why I said a microscope is very much essential for doing a strabismus surgery, so that you get the correct plane. Otherwise, if you perforate, you will end up with a lot of problems. And then conjunctival closure. That's equally important, because strabismus surgery is also a cosmetic surgery, so your conjunctival closure should be very, very good. Coming to the technique of resections, so in resection, the idea is to cut a part of the muscle. So you can see here, this part of the muscle has been cut. So you are strengthening the muscle by cutting the part of the tendon of the muscle. So this is the procedure of resection, you can see here. So once you put the knot and the desired amount of resection, you disinsert the muscle and then remove the extra part of the muscle. And this part is important, because the sclera is thinnest at the insertion. So you should be very, very careful while taking these bites, and then tie it correctly so that there is no central sag. So sometimes you may have a central sag, so which reduces the amount of resection, amount of correction you ought to get. So in case you have that one, you can probably put a minimal suture there, or sometimes you may prefer to use a double arm suture for each muscle, which reduces this possibility. Coming to the adjustable sutures, this again is a very good surgery, because in some cases where the normal dosage doesn't work, like in a small variable deviation or a restrictive strabismus, or if you're doing a resurgery, it's a very, very important tool, and a very good tool which you can use to get a desired result. So here you see, it's just like any other recession, but instead of tying the knot there, you just put a bow tie there. You just put a bow tie there. And then once the anesthesia effect wears off, if you're doing it under topical, you can do it immediately also. So you just check for the cover test and see whether you have achieved the correct desired result. So if not, you can just go back and either you pull it backwards or push it forwards, put on another bow tie, again do a cover test and see if the desired amount of correction has been achieved or not. And then you can put the final knot. So this is a very important tool for strabismus surgeons. But of course, it's not that every time this adjustable suture will give a perfect result. And that's the reason why many of us are not using it as a routine unless it is really necessary. Coming to the oblique muscles, tackling the oblique muscle, the most commonly performed surgery on the superior oblique is a superior oblique posterior tenectomy, where you remove a part of the muscle which are responsible for the depression. This anterior 1/3 is responsible for the torsion, so intorsion. So you don't want the torsion to suffer. So you leave behind the anterior 1/3 of the superior oblique and remove the posterior 2/3. And this coming to the inferior oblique, as Dr. Santhan Gopal said, it's the most forgiving muscle. And this surgery is showing an inferior oblique myectomy. You can do a myectomy, a recession, or anterior position of the inferior oblique. So this is the inferior oblique muscle there running across here. It's a thick pink muscle. You have to hook under visualization. You should never do a blind hooking, because there is a vortex vein closely associated with the inferior oblique, and if it ruptures, it causes very severe bleeding. So you first visualize it and then hook the whole muscle. And once the muscle is hooked, you just see behind, because many a times you may partly hook the muscle and leave behind some fibers behind that. So if you do that, you will not get the desired result. So you have to completely open that one. And then in this myectomy surgery, what we are doing is we just put a clamp on either side of the muscle and cut a part of the muscle. At least 5 mm of the muscle has to be cut for myectomy. In a recession, instead of cutting this one, you put a suture and then put the inferior oblique close to the insertion of the inferior rectus, depending on how much of correction is necessary. So you are now cutting the muscle. And once the muscle is cut, it's very important to cauterize the ends. Otherwise, inferior oblique is a very vascular muscle and bleeds very badly if you don't cauterize it. So that's cauterizing the ends of the muscle. Coming to the complications, complications can be either intra-op or post-op. Most often complication what you may expect is a hemorrhage, bleeding from the muscles. But rarer complication is a scleral perforation if you're not careful, and the most dreaded complication for any strabismus surgeon is a lost muscle. Post-operatively, you can have under overcorrection, slip muscle or lost muscle, and anterior segment ischemia if you are operating more than 3 recti muscle. So the factors influencing the surgical results could be age and type of the strabismus, the AC by A ratio, but of all, the most important is the experience of the surgeon. So the more experience you have, probably you'll probably get a better result from strabismus surgeries. Thank you. So I think we come to the end of the session, and we would like to take if any questions are there. Any questions for any of the previous speakers? So I thank my co-instructors for, yes sir. Yes.
I have a question. In case of recession,
yeah.
How's the hangback technique compared to the normal convention technique that you did?
Yeah, hangback you can.